leave me alone. Then you have this equation for the equations for equipotential or equipressure surfaces, and you can plot them easily, and you get a disk which is very fat, okay, not necessarily very thin disk on the equatorial plate. And there, and this is the funnel, this is like a chimney where there is no matter, and matter can actually get out of this axis, because centrifugal force keeps the matter away from the axis, and that allows the matter to. I think Dr. Saikia was also, I think Narayan and Unita and Nithananda, they also did some work in 1982 or something. So this was, and you can see the distribution here. Distribution of the disk, distribution of the angular momentum in the disk itself, which is not Keplerian, but it is intersecting with Keplerian typically at two different places. And therefore, and we typically we say, yes, at these two places, what happens is, why are they Keplerian? Because at these two places, this term is zero. And the inner point, because pressure is zero, the outer point, it is because pressure gradient is zero. So, here the pressure gradient is zero, so there is a high maximum pressure, and so there is a pressure maximum just like center of a star. And now we have basically a toroidal star. A star is like a torus moving around the black hole, okay? Moving around the black hole, and this is the center where the pressure gradient of course vanishes, and this somewhere here the pressure vanishes. Okay, so this is the thing. Alright. So the biggest problem was, this is an inconsistency which dragged me into the subject. In Chicago, there was nobody was doing attention. So I thought I met Pazinski, he came to give a talk there, and I really got interested because the apparent inconsistency. On the one hand, you are happy with the spectrum with a thin accretion disk. On the other hand, you need a thick accretion disk to be able to collimate jet and so on and produce jet. So that was something that we thought, how can it be true that this is the equipotential surfaces of the thick accretion disk and this is the your funnel in which the jets are collimated. Okay. So I got interested, and of course we wrote a paper there how to study them properly in general linguistic framework in Schwarzschild and third geometry in 1985. Now then we also started, we found that star that we are talking about, toroidal star, is extremely hot, 10 to the power 9 degrees plus, and this is the hottest place and the most dense place. And so we started calculating the nuclear reaction. So when the matter is falling towards the black hole, what are the nuclear reactions which can take place? So when the matter is coming from the companion star, okay, I think Sankar, so the matter is coming from the companion star, and the matter as it is falling towards the black hole, you can see that this composition is changing, okay? And this composition, unfortunately, it is changing. On the one hand, the matter is changing for a short time, so it's a one short process, but on the other hand, you are having continuous supply. So you can burn matter, a lot of matter continuously, and eject them in the form of jets, maybe 50% of the matter goes out as jets. So you can increase the metallicity of the galaxy in this process. So you you need to have supernovas to do that. Even the cosmicity of jets will have anomalous isotopes and all kinds of funny things. If you are careful, if the viscosity is sufficiently low, the viscosity is very, very high, so that matter is falling very rapidly, then the composition will change very rapidly. So at the same time, while this was going on, one of my colleagues was working in University of Chicago in Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, John Hawley, almost contemporary, just 1 year senior to me. He was doing this simulation of active accretion disk into a black hole, falling into a black hole. At that time, there was no theory for the matter which is falling onto a black hole and thick simultaneous. There was only theory for the thin accretion disk. Or thick accretion disk which is only rotating. So there was no advection term was attached. Advection term was attached only in the with the boundary flow. So no wonder when you compare his result with the heat extending solution, you can see the solid one is the analytical thing, and the dotted one. So you can see that there is a big discrepancy. So people thought he was happy. Papers were getting accepted and published. The very fact that the nature is almost reproducible, so that is okay. Register details. And then you can, he also did the simulation like that. Again, if you see here, if I can bring the cursor, this is the numerical simulation data, and this is the data coming from the thick accretion disk. They don't match, but still people are happy. Why? Because this general shape is matching. Why they are not matching? Because this thick accretion disk did not have an aberration term. Okay. So that was a pathetic thing. And so this was also one of the reasons that I thought something would be should be done in this subject, adding the, so to make the generalized boundary flow with rotation and viscosity and cooling, etc., so that we can have matching, perfect matching with the theoretical thing. So there are a lot of room. When we started the subject just started, and there are a lot of room. Everywhere I see it is incomplete. So in the meantime, something else happened that the purpose. People are also trying hard. So when they people realize Abramovich, Jurek, and Paczynski, Bhojan and Charny, etc., they realize that the thick accretion, that paper in this was chopped up at this was hilarious. Something has to be done. Something has to be done so that matter from this was hilarious can actually enter into black hole. So they try to have a transonic solution only in the inner this was hilarious, just the inner part. Okay. So they got a one sonic point here to which the matter is falling. But then that was not the entire story actually. Some, you have to, when you try to solve the problem totally, you find there are a lot of interesting things which are there, like there are theorems where one theorem is that when you are falling into a black hole, the solution must be supersonic. Mach number has to be larger than 1 because the velocity is velocity of light on the horizon, whereas some speed is always less than 1. So that is one like a theorem. The other thing is that of course, this innermost sonic, and there are n number of sonic points. There are 2 sonic points when the matter is falling with the rotation, and the inner sonic point is definitely because of the general relativistic effect. The third theorem kind of thing is that a sonic point, the flow must be subcategorical. Why I am saying kind of thing? That in presence of cooling, sometimes you can have all supercategorical also, but extremely rare cases. The small region of the current space allows you to have. But when the matter is falling through the inner sonic coil, it must become subcategorical. That is a that is something that is a theorem. I mean, you cannot avoid it. And then the next part is that if there are 2 sonic coils and you find that the entropy of the inner sonic coil is higher compared to the other, the matter actually can go from the outer sonic point, it has a shock formation, and then passes through the inner sonic coil by increasing the entropy. So that is then the shock transition can is also possible. Not only the neutron star and the other white dwarfs that I pointed out earlier, but even for black holes. Okay, and that means that the accretion onto black hole also slows down at a let us say 10-15 Schwarzschild radius because of the centrifugal force, and then it starts becoming supersonic, subsonic, supersonic to subsonic transition, then it enters into black hole supersonic. So that region we call the boundary layer of the black hole. Now this is very something very strange because black hole doesn't have a surface, what to talk about its boundary. But the fact that the centrifugal force is very strong and it keeps the matter out very far away, let us say 15 Schwarzschild radius away, and that is the place where the matter jumps from supersonic to subsonic and basically dissipates its kinetic energy, and the energy becomes thermal and it starts radiating, the jet comes from that region. So for all practical purposes, that is really the boundary layer of a black hole. So that was a new concept that we introduced into the subject. Now the shock of course was not new. Shock idea was that because the solar outflow, the coronal mass ejection, etc., people have been studying shocks in the 1960s and 70s. And even Fukue showed that even for accretion to black hole, there could be one solution, for example, 2 solutions actually found, the supersonic shock. So this shock can form. And all we did was to make it a general solution, find out the entire parameter space, try to find out all possible, we extracted all possible juice out of it, basically, what is the implication of having a shock just outside the black hole. All you have to do is to take the all set of all the equations. Of course, this all entirely hydrodynamic. So we have now added the advection term, d dv dx, that was 89. D dv dx, except term, since this is equilibrium square by x cube in centrifugal gravity, and this is the centrifugal force, lambda square by x cube. Lambda is the specific angular momentum. So this is a radial momentum equation, basically force balance in radial direction, continuity equation. Azimuthal angular momentum is still transported by viscosity. Here I have replaced by Sakharov-Sonnier viscosity alpha parameter and the entropy equation, because you can produce heat, you can also dissipate heat, and the difference must be, this is a first law of thermodynamics, which basically is a differential version. To solve these equations, and then you should be able to have the generalized bonding, Keplerian, thin, all the disks should come out as a special, all the disks should come out as special cases. Now first of course we solved it in 89, and then we generalized to Card geometry, and we found that this is the entire parameter space, and different region of the parameter space produces different solutions. If you have very low energy and low angular momentum, it is like a bonding flow, but as you increase the angular momentum little by little, you find that there is a topology here which does not allow a shock production. It just goes like this, but there is no Rankine-Hutton condition, it is not satisfied, so matter continues to go like this. So it is a steady solution, but if you do a numerical simulation, then you see that the shock works, but the shock oscillates. There is this, this solution, for example, allows you to have a permanent solution, a shock, and the matter passes to the inner sonic point and enters into the atom. Here it is the shock in the outflow, but no shock in the inflow. Here there is the oscillating shock in the outflow, here is again like a bonding flow. So all possible types of solutions come out, but if the energy is negative, the solutions are bound. Okay. You have to add viscosity or cooling in order to have these solutions to be unbound and to make a Keplerian disk. So Keplerian disk also will come out of this provided I add viscosity. I don't want to go into detail. When you do the numerical simulation, of course the shock forms. So shock forms because they are the steady solution, they are stable solution, and you don't have to do anything. Just inject matter, go home, and the computer will, when the next day you come back, you see that the perfect shock has produced almost exactly where you predicted it, and there is a turbulence extra which you did not have it in your menu. So the shock location is a little bit outside because of the turbulence pressure. Otherwise it's okay. And the matter is coming out as a outflow. You see, if I add the vectors, matter is actually coming out like that. So we have shock, this is a boundary layer, so this is axisymmetric, okay? This is a black hole sitting at the center, and this is basically axisymmetric for us. So then, if you now plot the temperature contour, I will come to that. In the meantime, we did something extra. Now that we find that very thick accretion disks are produced, and it's a very generic thing, we thought that what happened if this is not barotropic. What we did was, we removed the barotropic equation of state and we immediately find that this flow, which is apparently hydrodynamic, starts producing a magnetic field on its own at initial. You do not have to start a magnetic field to begin with, and that magnetic field is stretched like mad by the differential motion, and we claim, this was in our Nature paper, this is 1992, I wrote it in the monkey notices and elaborated in Nature, we claim that the initial, that the universe, the magnetic field of the universe has actually started in this way. Because you did not have, the universe did not have any magnetic field to begin with, and when the first black hole started, then you automatically have magnetic fields, which are, these fields are produced, these total fields are getting ejected by buoyancy and into the universe. So it spread it out in the flow of the universe by all the black holes independently, and now we see magnetic fields due to this. That was one of our suggestions. Now just to visualize, this is one of the simulations I did in 1992, just to show you that this boundary layer actually forms. This is a very low angular momentum. This is a no boundary layer. Matter is supersonic everywhere. Red means supersonic, blue is subsonic. And if you add angular momentum a little bit more, it is still totally supersonic. Then you add a little bit more, 1.7. Marginally stable angular momentum is 1.83. So we are talking about angular momentum which is around marginally stable, not like you don't need a large number. So then you see that the subsonic flow, blue in color, becomes supersonic, becomes subsonic again, it forms a torus, and then there is outflow on the side, and then it becomes supersonic again, then entering into black hole. So this disk actually forms. and then we say, okay, now that it forms, let us try to compare the theoretical solution which is solid and the dashed solution which is numerical. You can now compare with this or this comparison and this comparison. This was John Hall's simulation in 85, best simulation of the day, but you can see that the theory was lacking, that the advection term. Once you add the advection term and predict the shock, the flow, and these are the numerical simulations by all three different codes. One is from Los Alamos code, the other is Korean code, the other is Italian code. All of them produce the shock at the same place where theory predicted. In other words, where we don't predict shock, it also, the simulation also doesn't show any shock. So what happened is, therefore, that we now are confirmed, we are now very much believed that these shocks are not means, they actually form around the black hole. Matter does stop at 30 kilometers or 40 kilometers away from the black hole and produce subsonic, you know, release energy and so on. So this happened, this is a fact of life. Now, not everybody stops like that. If I, in a wrong region of the parameter space, if I inject with the wrong energy or angular momentum, the shock actually starts oscillating, you can see. But this oscillation is because the Rankine-Ohmian condition was not satisfied, so it is continuously searching for the location where it would be satisfied, but it doesn't find it. So that simulation, ultimately you will come to the upper while to show that that probably is the reason, is the positivity oscillation that we see on black hole X-rays in the black hole. Now let us now come back to our simulation and draw the temperature contours, okay? If you draw the temperature contours of constant temperature, lo and behold, these contours look like the contours of thick accretion disk. So what happened? If we started with a disk with a large amount of advection and everything, then in the shock, suddenly the velocity component went down by a factor of 4 or factor of 7 depending on the adiabatic index. So it is as good as having no velocity at all. So then therefore, as good as talking about the Polish donuts. So these Polish thick accretion disks that we are discussing, the condition of thick accretion disk is already now satisfied in the post-shock region. So now we know how to produce thick accretion disk. It is nothing but the post-shock region. And then this produces, and now we know the outflow is coming out from here. So all the ideas of forming outflows and collimation and so on still remains, except that the solution is now much better. It has the advection term. This has now unified, let us say, thick disk and the bondy type, slow rotating bondy type flow. Now how to go to Kepler and this from here? For Kepler and this, I will come to this. For Kepler, to understand the Kepler and this, we need to know the role of viscosity. Because Kepler and this has to be, angular momentum is distributed, so even if you inject some number, that has to be distributed. So you have to transport the momentum and therefore angular momentum. And so you need a viscosity. If you add viscosity, the topology of the solutions change drastically. You can see that the O type sonic point becomes spiral, just like single harmonic oscillator, the phase space. It becomes like a damped harmonic oscillator phase space. Even if the high viscosity damps faster, low viscosity damps slower. So this topology changes, and you can still have a shock provided the viscosity is not high enough. Now my claim now is that this, the most important effect to my understanding after Sakura Sunilayev is the fact people did not realize it that time. I also did not realize it that time. But now I believe there is this situation. If the viscosity is very small, then of course it still forms a shock and enters. If the viscosity is high, then of course there is no longer a shock solution. But what happens is that in between these two, what is the cause, what is high and what is low with respect to what? If you draw the topology, you find that there is one viscosity somewhere in between. Why the topology changes from here to there? You may not be able to see the difference at a first glance, but you can see that the topology in this case, the lower branch has opened up, okay? And in this case, higher branch is only open and going inside. So these two topologies are different, and the angular momentum is alpha is different, 0.01, 0.02. In between, topology is such that the same solution goes to the both the sonic points. This is really, in my opinion, the best thing that happened to accretion process after Sakura-Sumi. The reason is, you know now that if the viscosity is less than this critical list, there you have a Schwab solution and everything that I talked about. If the viscosity is larger than this one point the number, then you have typical typical Sakura-Sumi FDEs. Now, beta, because now it automatically enters through the inner sonic point, and so you don't have to chop at the three source latency. So you have a better version of Sakura-Sumi FDEs. So you have a Keplerian list, sonic point, entering black hole, again unification there. There is unification already thick and bonded, rotating bonded and the thick disk. And this is the culprit. This topology is the culprit. This distinguishes between these two types. So now, when we do the simulation, we find that we have no viscosity, it is a strong shock. If the viscosity is added up, weaker shock, a little bit further out. And if we had a very large viscosity, the shock moves to infinity. And what is left over in the disk is a Keplerian disk passing through the inner sonic point. And the angular momentum distribution in the coastal region also becoming very strong. Of course, this much more work has been done since then. Mr. Kinsu Giri will be giving far more serious talks on this. Now, in the meantime, not only viscosity, of course, cooling heating are taking place. So we already wrote more than Sponholz and Chakraborty in 1996. We added cooling effects and show that the shock enters inside. So what happened is, in the presence of viscosity, shock goes outside. In the presence of cooling, shock goes inside. In the presence of both viscosity and cooling, shock remains. So parameter space, there is still some region of the large region of the parameter space where the shock actually forms, and you cannot do anything about it. So now what has to be done is that you imagine an accretion flow whose viscosity on the equatorial plane, this is the equatorial plane, is let us say high. So this side is let us say viscosity, this side is the Keplerian, this side is the equatorial plane is zero, and this is above the equatorial plane, this is below the equatorial plane. You start with a large amount of viscosity, let us say 0.02 alpha, and let us say alpha critical for the initial condition is somewhere here. And you suddenly see that up to this region, the viscosity is higher than the critical, so this will be the Keplerian. And from here to there, viscosity is less than the Keplerian, less than the critical, so the flow will remain sub-Keplerian. In other words, we have been able to now see that this is going to become a little more complicated, but it's totally coming from theory. It's not an illusion, not a cartoon diagram. So you have a disk whose region is larger than the critical viscosity, will produce a Keplerian disk. Less than the critical viscosity, will remain sub-Keplerian, and that region will produce centrifugal dominated boundary layer or CN ball for the shock, and this post-shock region pops up like a thick accretion disk and enters into black hole totally. So you now have grand unification of the Keplerian disk, rotating bonding, thick accretion disk, and your jet collimation and everything. So when you start with a general equation, you do get a general solution. There is nothing wrong in that. So when you started applying for it in NASA, we started applying for it when I was with Titachuk, Sri Chakraborty Titachuk 1995, to say that look, now the question comes, I don't want to know what the critical viscosity is, I don't want to know what the viscosity is at all. All I want to know is how much amount of matter is falling in the Keplerian component and how much matter is falling in the sub-Keplerian component. And these two divisions will automatically be done by the value of critical viscosity, which I don't want to know. So m dot 1 and m dot 2 are good enough. So instead of having 1 m dot plus viscosity parameter, I now have 2 m dot parameters and no viscosity parameter. So if I have high accretion rate, then it produces large amount of shock photons, black body photons, and we have, let us say, some accretion rate of this component. That component produces a post-shock region and is cooled down by quantum scattering by this shock photon. So once it is cooled down, the spectrum is soft and we call it a soft set of the black hole. If the accretion area is very small, the accretion area is very large, you cannot cool down all the electrons, so you have a hard seamless cool down. There are many complications in this nonlinear process, but this region remains typically hot and you produce hard X-ray. So when you see a spectrum of a black hole candidate, you see both hard disk components and soft components, and you can see there is a distinction between the soft and the hard states. We call them soft state and hard state. This is our paper in we wrote in 95, saying that look, but just by adjusting these two rates, you can now go from hard state to soft state just by changing one of the adjacent rates. Okay. So we still believe with your far more conviction that this is precisely what is going on. Okay. Now, and all observations can be understood within the framework of this theoretical result. Namely, one does not have to change the basic picture. And as you have noticed by now, you don't have to look for the quantum cloud anymore. This is the quantum cloud. Inner part of the disk, which is produced by the mainly by the subcuprion flow, which is intersecting this low energy photon and producing the hard energy photon. So there is no longer confusion in where the quantum cloud is sitting and doing the quantization. So that basically solves a large number of problems. And what is more, if I start in the parameter region, which is a large region, and such that this the Rankine-Cooney condition is not satisfied, I have already shown you that the shock is oscillating. So when this shock oscillates, the amount of photon that is intersects also oscillates, and therefore the amount of X-rays that are coming out is also oscillating, and therefore you see quasi-periodic oscillation of black hole dynamics. So we say that look, quasi-periodic oscillation, we don't have to create a new model. This itself is good enough to explain why X-rays should be oscillating at this particular frequency. And the frequency is dictated by the distance from the black hole. This is basically the interval time scale of the matter from the coast of India to the black hole. So this is n number of things here about. Then we also hypothesize that look, the outflow itself has to come from this region only because this is a hot uptop region. And so the end of the entire disk, all the models like Blanford's pain and many other disks which are the system, which are taking care of the entire disk to produce the jets, we said look, jets could not be produced from the entire disk. There is nothing there, there is not much energy to produce jet, but this fellow can is highly energized. And it can at least start the initial origin can be only this region, namely 10 to 20 squash. So